Welcome back to our channel, and if you're new here, normally we make travel videos.
But many people really like to know what our travels cost us.
If you don't know how we travel, for the last, well, almost 3 years, we've been traveling by motorhome full time around Europe. And every year we wrap up the last 12 months and we put it together in one beast of a spreadsheet. And we look at all our averages, we look at our totals, we give an idea what you can expect to spend if you travel like us.
Now, we know you might not travel like us, so we do break things up and we're going to discuss all these values so that you can see how you should maybe adjust them and where you'd want to spend more than us, where you'd want to spend less than us. Having 3 years worth of these figures makes it a very interesting comparison from year to year. So right at the end, we'll be discussing that too.
Welcome to our channel. We're Andre and Lisa, married South African-Italian couple who have been traveling together for 20 years, exploring more than 50 countries. Since 2018, we've been full-time nomads, with our goal being to make travel a sustainable long-term way of life. For the past 3 years, we've been winding our way around Europe with our 21-year-old motorhome, Millie. We're starting 2024 with an exciting adventure to Morocco, and although our plans for the year might change, we're hoping to visit Sardinia for the first time, get back to Denmark for summer, then make our way via Eastern Europe to Greece for the winter. So hit that subscribe button and join our adventure. Let me start off quickly first by saying we're not going to go by country by country by country. We're going to give you all the countries we've actually visited this last 12 months, and we're going to do a rough We're going to do exact comparison.
Absolutely accurate
comparison between those different destinations. Show you how long we've spent in each destination, the distances we've traveled, the average cost we spent on fuel. If there were any additional transport costs, we're going to show you averages for food, dining out, entertainment, accommodation. And we're going to call out sort of the anomalies, the ones that stand out. We don't all travel the same. As full-time travelers, we do travel slower than most.
We have been called the tortoise travelers.
But if you haven't seen, 2 videos ago, we put out a video that sort of recaps our journey of 2023. And surprisingly enough, we made it to 18 countries.
Even to us, we felt like a slow year. We traveled very nicely at a relaxed pace. And yet, that's how much you can see if you do just sort of keep on the move.
So make sure to check out that video if you want an overview of our highlights, our standouts of our country-specific visits. And it was actually a fun video to make. So we're going to touch on a lot of similar things, but this time we're talking about costs. And I think what we're going to do is I'm going to put this big spreadsheet on the screen now.
And cover our faces.
We're gonna make it bigger and bigger and bigger until we get to the end and we can see the big picture and we're gonna talk about it. So shall we start? Okay, let's kick off with.
Let's see how far we traveled in 2023 and see what distance we traveled per country.
So just loosely, we did a loop starting in the south of Italy. We went across from there with a ferry to Albania. We did a short section through Greece, North Macedonia, Kosovo, Serbia, Montenegro, Bosnia and Herzegovina. Went back through Serbia into Hungary. From Hungary, went to Slovakia. From Slovakia, we passed through Czechia into Germany. And we spent a few months in Denmark after making our way through Germany again, through the Netherlands, Belgium, a hell of a loop through France. Made a dash through Andorra. And for the last 2 months, more than 2 months, we've been in Spain. But right now, we're actually in Morocco. So if you haven't seen our last video, make sure to follow, subscribe, and check out our trip in Morocco.
Before you forget, don't forget to smash the like button. It does help us out. It's the least you can do.
Yeah, for those guys on TVs, you press the up button and you see the like there and you click on it. Easy.
All right.
It's quite interesting, these numbers. Now, generally, it's not 11,300 kilometers is not a lot for almost a year's travel. So maybe this is the point where we got to show, why does the number of nights say 288 and not 365, Lisa?
We spent 77 days of the year in South Africa. We took a little break from the European winter. And so that is excluded from our budget here. And we are discussing the 288 nights that we spent in our motorhome in Europe.
These were consecutive nights. So we returned from South Africa in beginning of March, and we started traveling.
We either talk about totals or we talk about averages. So everything is still relevant for anybody planning a year-long trip.
Okay, so let's look at these numbers quickly. Like you say, the big countries obviously going to draw the biggest distances. Now, we'll come to cost of transport in a moment, but let's just focus on the number of nights we spent in every country. The standouts here are Italy. We started the year in Italy, so we spent quite a full month in Italy. We actually had to do a revision on a motorhome there. We had to get our paperwork in order before we started the trip, and we really love that part of Puglia, so you go check out those videos. In Italy, we only stayed in 5 places in that month. We never paid for any accommodation. Some of these, we were limited by time, like, for example, Kosovo. We were limited by insurance.
Albania, the same. We decided to only purchase 2 weeks worth of insurance in Albania. Those were the two countries that was necessary for us to purchase insurance. And then you'll also see that some countries we were in twice. So Serbia, we were in for 16 days and then we returned to try and see a little bit more. But after 3 days back in Serbia, it was just too hot. So we moved on. And in Germany, we spent almost 2 weeks on the way up towards Denmark and then again afterwards on the way out. When we say we travel slowly, what's interesting is to look at the number of locations that we stayed at versus the number of nights. And we won't look at anyone in specific, but you can see that over the 288 nights, we stayed in 110 different locations. So that's actually almost always 2 to 3 nights per stop.
France, you can see the ratio is quite high because of the distance. You tend to move a little bit faster, where like in Italy we were concentrating our time in a specific area, so you move a lot slower. From the number of locations, the next interesting one is how many of those places have we actually paid for and how do they differ from each other.
And this is where 2023 was really a game-changing year for us. It wasn't something that we planned specifically. It was something that sort of just evolved the longer we live in our motorhome and travel like this. We only paid for 17 nights of accommodation for the entire year.
If you travel full-time and you do this for a long time, you prefer avoiding official stops or campsites. Firstly, we don't need it. We're fully off-grid. We got enough electricity. We never need electric hookup. We use gas for most of our appliances otherwise, and we have refillable LPG system. And we also don't have a cassette toilet anymore, so we actually use a separating system. So that gives us the freedom of spending time in other locations more often.
And water can be found easily throughout the entire Europe.
Now let's touch on the anomalies. Albania, average of 750 per night times 4 is mostly paid parking in cities to get a bit of security. Kosovo, we paid for one night in Peja, I think. And then Montenegro, what makes Montenegro different is we actually purchased a annual national park pass. It costs €13.50 per person and you can visit all the national parks. And you can actually overnight in these parks if you didn't know. You pay for the vehicle for the night. I think it's €4 depending on the park.
Depending on the park, and some parks also without that additional per night fee.
Then Bosnia, we paid for 2 nights.
Just outside of Mostar, we decided to go to a lovely little river camp and go to Mostar by bus. So that's why the price there went up. It was the only campsite that we went to for the entire year.
But it was a heat wave and we needed shade. And shade and solar doesn't like each other. So that's pretty much it. In the Netherlands, we paid once at a campsite to visit the city. And
in Prague also. Sorry, that was the only other one.
That's right. And that's it. 17 paid for nights in 288. And I'll tell you what, it's not like we went out trying to do that. We can probably do 0 if you really try.
No, we always say specifically, actually, it shouldn't be about spending as little as possible. No. But the truth is, it's just become more convenient for us to stay in places which are not paid sites because you normally have a bit more space around you. It's more pleasant. But whenever there is the need for it, we say go to a paid place, especially to see cities.
Yeah, just my takeaway from this is some countries lend themselves easier to this type of free type of traveling. France, it's super easy to stay in official motorhome stops, service stops, absolutely free. And countries like the Balkans, I suppose it depends on your tolerance levels. Now, you don't have that many options for camping there. We right now find ourselves in Morocco. And I'll tell you now, next year's budget or this year's budget is going to look different because here you tend to pay for everywhere you park. That's just the way it is. Unless you have a 4x4 vehicle and you can venture into the desert, I don't know.
And I would also say to you, if you're planning on doing this for the first time, do not think that you are going to according to our year and just completely be off grid. This takes some getting used to, not only from a vehicle perspective to be completely off grid with regards to services and electricity and everything, but also just from a what you're comfortable with point of view. It does take some time to get used to and to start learning where are places where you can overnight for free comfortably. And when should you pay for parking, rather?
When you do plan this journey and you want to use our numbers as a reference, you plan to spend at least 10 euros per day on average, meaning you're not going to go to a site every single day. That means you're probably going to go to a site 3 or 4 times a week, a paid for site, and sort of mix it up with other types of parking. Sometimes of the year, it's going to be a lot more expensive, depending where you find yourself. If you're competing with the tourists in the peak of summer in places like Italy, the paid for campsites get very expensive. If you look at our previous year's 2 years budgets, you'll notice that that's where the difference is. We used to spend a lot more on accommodation.
Okay, so if you would like to have more information on that, have a look at our previous budget videos and also on our website, wewillnomad.com, that all the budget information is also there with an example of what campsites cost and what they look like.
Okay, let's move on for accommodation for now. Let's go to just transport costs. And the bulk of it is obviously going towards fuel. Fuel made up almost 80% of our transport cost, and we included ferries, tolls, and under tolls, we also put vignettes.
So some countries, a vignette is required if you want to drive on the main motorways. Now, mostly you can avoid this completely, but we were in a bit of a hurry this year to head north. So we paid for vignettes in Hungary, Slovakia, and Czechia. Is that correct?
That's right. No, it's not super, super expensive. It's actually worth your while. It takes the stress out of it. Albania, you have to buy insurance. It wasn't included. Well, we had to buy insurance. It was not included in our green card. So that pushes up that average price a little bit. And then in Kosovo, we got nailed with third-party insurance. For some reason, our vehicle is classified as a truck.
So we had to pay 77 euro for 2 weeks in Kosovo in terms of insurance, which is quite high.
Included in the average or the general cost is some public transport, like a bus or a train we took. But you can see the total is actually
so small,
pretty low. That's only like 2% of our total cost. Just cast your eyes on the average fuel cost and you'll see that there's a vast difference between the different countries. And these are the average cost per liter for fuel throughout the duration of our stay there. And keeping in mind that was a span of like 10 months. So fuel costs do fluctuate over time.
But one that really, really stood out was North Macedonia, where you can see it was an average of only 1.10 euro per liter. And then, of course, the most expensive is the Netherlands at just under 2 euro.
We did find as we came through France that the prices went up and down. It also touched on 2 euro mark. Although the Spain says 151, recently we've been able to put in fuel for under 130 a litre in Spain, just to put that in perspective. Next topic of discussion, how much do we spend on food? That includes groceries and as well as dining out. Now, you'll see that as I put the numbers on here, you might be like, don't you guys ever go dine out? Actually, we don't.
We don't really.
We don't really. The thing is, like, it can add up super quickly. You go out, maybe in a country like any Western European country.
We don't do it.
Just go have a coffee and a pastry. Thinking of a meal for two people is 50, 60, 70 euros.
Including drinks. Just like that. Forget it.
You're going to spend 100 euros for breakfast and one meal a day for two people. If you're lucky, that's not even high. Now, countries that is affordable to eat out are like the Western Balkans, is obviously, and places like Spain, you can sort of get away with spending a lot less on average, I would say. But the reality is we live in a motorhome. We do try to enjoy local produce, and where possible, we'll try local food.
I don't think anybody will say, if you've been watching our videos, that we don't try enough of the local delicacies.
No, that's one of our problems,
but
actually.
But we have to limit our spending somewhere if we want to continue a life like this. And this is where we do limit it. Luckily, we've got Chef Andre.
Lucky Lisa.
Lucky me.
Lucky Lisa. So if you look at the groceries per day, these are average per day per country. Now, it's a bit fuzzy because sometimes you go through Germany and you stock up before you go to Denmark. So if you look at Denmark, for example, we only spend 20 euros on average per day. But we didn't actually buy a lot of groceries there. For example, now just keep in mind, these numbers do not include alcohol. Right?
Yeah, we took alcohol.
So there's no alcohol included. I'll show you the graph again.
We'll be in the total again.
Groceries, dining out, Lisa's chocolate and an ice cream bill. And then alcohol actually make a surprisingly big portion. So if you don't drink, you can save a lot. But generally, we want to try a local beverage. Like in Spain, we're really enjoying cava.
And I think that added significantly to this alcohol bill.
Lisa developed a cava problem.
And not to mention, we stocked up with rakia in Serbia as well, which we're still carrying through Morocco because that's the only alcohol we're going to be having in Morocco.
But we opted not to put the alcohol in this daily groceries average because it might skew it completely and it's not really fair on to give you a good perspective.
It's hard to allocate it per country.
That's
right. So we do add it in at the end. But when it comes to per country, I think you can see that the higher end countries are Hungary, Slovakia and Czech. And that's because we were also only there for a few days and there were countries where we did want to go and eat out and experience the local cuisine.
These averages are a little bit tricky because you got to remember we had so many nights in a place. So for example, as an example, let's look at Slovakia. Mm-hmm. We only have 4 nights in Slovakia. So that means you have to times that number by 4 to know how much we actually spent there on dining. So it's not the problem with averages, it creates a perspective and you have to know how to get to the actual number. If you go to Italy, 32 nights at €2, yes, we only spent €64. That was probably all on
pasticciotto.
Exactly. But in a place like Serbia, for example, it seems like dining out is quite high.
But it was because we could afford to dine out more.
Yeah,
the same goes for North Macedonia, where you can see our dining out is fairly high. And that's because we could actually go to a wine farm and enjoy wine tasting there as well as a meal.
So just keep in mind when you look at this column, it's not a true reflection of actual cost for that country because it's going to depend on you and how you prefer to spend your money. We want to visit destinations to experience the food and the culture and the vibe. Often we visit less touristy places nowadays, and if we do want to experience some local food, we'll try and choose a place that gives us a combination of a good atmosphere and not go to a top-end 3 Michelin star restaurant expecting the best quality gourmet food, just because that's not what it's about for us. It's about the experience, hey?
And often it'll be more about the ambiance where we are, be able to watch people, something like that, more so than just the food. So just looking at some specific examples here where you can see the groceries are particularly low and they don't reflect the country accurately is the Netherlands as well as Andorra, because there we obviously didn't do grocery shopping. So that's why the value is low.
Okay, so let's just look at the averages. Once again, these are averages, total average for groceries per day over 288 days. And that's €15 a day. Now, keeping in mind that's for the two of us, excluding alcohol. And I don't think you can really complain with that, eh?
No, I don't think so. Not for the way we eat.
We could probably eat for less.
I mean, we're not skinny and no. We don't eat the same.
Hey, man, speak for yourself. Insulting.
We're not that skinny and okay. We don't eat the same thing, rice and dry bread every day. That I can guarantee you. But it takes a conscious effort to be able to do this. You have to buy local groceries and cook for yourself. You can't expect to eat out at this budget.
Look, this is where you've got that choice. How much do you want to really spend? And this is one of those categories we can really make a difference. You can't really change the amount you're going to spend on fuel if you want to cover a certain distance. But you've got control over this category. So this is something you have to think about and apply your individual preferences to.
And also, if you are considering renting a motorhome for a trip, this is where we always say to people that renting a motorhome might not cost you less per day than renting an Airbnb, for instance, or staying in a hotel. But you have the option of spending less on food if this is the way in which you want to do it. This is where you really can cut costs by traveling in a motorhome through Europe.
Because we do get questions a lot of people asking us about how feasible it is to rent a motorhome for, say, a week or 11 days and go to a specific country. And then we think about the cost efficiency of it. So let's just wrap this up quickly on the last category that's on this list, and that's cell phone and data. Mm-hmm. If you look at it, you'll see it's much of the muchness. Yeah.
We've always said that you need about a euro a day for cell, no matter where you are. And that is per person, because in our case, we've actually got three SIMs running always. We've each got one in our phone, and then we've got a third SIM in the van, which is used for security, as well as our larger data things, uploading YouTube videos, watching YouTube.
So the way we do it, we each have a home SIM, in this case, the Italian SIM card. So it's a relatively cheap. We've spent like €6 a month on it. And that gives us full roaming across the EU, but it limits the amount of roaming data we have available. So in every country, we'll try and figure out what is the best data SIM available to us, and we'll purchase a data SIM there. The longer you're on the destination, the more sense it makes. In the Western Balkans, for example, we managed to buy a SIM that roams across all of the Western Balkans. It's not necessarily the cheapest, but it's very convenient, so you don't have to keep having to rebuy SIMs everywhere you go.
And that was in Albania. If you want more information on that, all that information is on our website.
We also did an Albania-specific video if you're interested in more detail on Albania. So countries that stand out where it's, well, look, SIMs are available freely. We don't use any other form of internet connectivity. As you can see, if we average less than €2 per day, it's less than €60. And we probably consume about 100 gigs of data per month in total. So it doesn't make sense to pay for anything else. The best option is just to get local SIM cards.
And you'll see over here that there's a slight variance, but not too much. The only one that stands out is our home country of Italy, when we have more data on our Italian SIMs, which is then half the price.
We don't need to get an extra SIM, exactly. Okay, so what we're going to do now is we're going to look at a quick breakdown that brings us to the averages. You'll see that there's extra three categories that's not actually in the table, because it's actually quite insignificant.
So what you'll see is that food, even though we spend so little on food per day, food still makes up the large majority of our spending at 65% almost. And second to that is our transport costs, which we've already discussed in a breakdown at 24%. This year, we spend very, very little on overnighting costs accommodation, so that only accounted for 2.5%. Cell and data is the next biggest one at 3.7%. And then we'll go to our LPG, which is a small percentage, 2.6, and that is roughly 80 cents on average per day that we spend on LPG.
So we never plug into shore power, and it's our only source of heating. So we run our fridge off LPG 24 hours a day. We heat our water, we heat our motorhome during cold spells, and we cook with it. So it's 80 cents. I suppose it's a good deal.
Sightseeing is a very, very small percentage. We didn't really have any big sightseeing expenses. That was the one advantage of traveling through the Western Balkans and going into Denmark, cutting across beautiful countries like France and Spain. There's just so much nature to enjoy. And that was sort of the theme of this year.
And the last one is laundry, which is also super small, a total of €140 for the duration. And it's just over €10 per month. Okay, that brings us to the actual total. So I'm going to show you all the averages per day per country. Now, whether this is relevant is not the point. It's just a fun little game. And the only number of real interest is right at the bottom. And it shows you our average spending per day on these categories is €30.51 per day over 288 days. And that includes all this money we spent on fuel, transport, cell and data, accommodation, food.
Alcohol.
Does it include alcohol?
Alcohol is included in this.
Alcohol is included. So for 30 odd euros a day, I think we're actually getting pretty good value. So what we can now do is to show you a quick comparison between 2023 numbers and our 2022 numbers, and see where we spent more, where we spent less. Just to give you an idea, did the way we travel maybe make a difference?
Very often when we travel, we think, oh, I think we might be spending a little bit too much on food, or oh, now we're not spending on this. But there's almost this way that everything comes to balance.
We autocorrect in a way. You sort of know, it's not always a good thing, before I say this, because you go to a cheaper country and you're like, ooh, now I can go dine out.
The bakery is so cheap.
And the beer is so amazing. So you tend to spend more on the things you wouldn't normally do. It's something you have to sort of be mindful of, eh?
And I think this is one thing that the more you travel and the more you do this, the more automatically it happens. And when you log your numbers, the easier it is to be able to do this, because you're just more aware. But I had actually thought that this year we spend more on food per day.
Just on pastries.
just on pastries. But we left Italy, so we stopped spending money on gelatos. And you'll see that the difference is minuscule. We pretty much 20 euro a day for both 2022 and 2023. Accommodation is where the big difference is between 2022 and 2023. And I think we've already touched on that, that is where you can make a saving if you do not pay for campsites and overnighting.
That's a big change we've really made in the past year. Everything else is pretty much the same.
And you can see that for cell data, LPG, sightseeing, laundry, all very, very similar. So when you look at the total, we actually ended up spending less this year on average per day. And that was predominantly due to us no longer spending on accommodation.
So that sort of wraps up what we've spent on average on these categories. And I hope it helps you to sort of give you an idea of what you can expect, but it's not that simple. Obviously, there are some expenses we're not including here. If you own your own motorhome and you travel with it full time, I can tell you now you're going to spend more per kilometer on maintenance cost than on fuel. That is just a reality. Now, it doesn't sound possible, but if you think about it, if we spent we spent about 2,000 euros on fuel and transport and
whatnot. In total for the entire year.
If you have to service your vehicle, if you have to replace the tires, if you have to do basic maintenance like
suspension parts,
never mind talking about breakdowns, mm-hmm. How about insurance for your vehicle, cost of tax and registration, all those things are not included. So those costs is almost equal to what you would expect to pay per kilometer. And obviously the further you drive, the lower that cost comes for maintenance.
So our ratio of what we spend on the vehicle versus our fuel cost is quite high because we travel slower, so we spend less on fuel. So for us, one of the fixed expenses is our insurance per year.
I know it depends on the country you are from. One little hack we can offer you is to join like a camping club or motorhoming or caravan association and then see if they can offer you insurance as part of a group package. Normally they can offer you something a lot more competitive. And that's exactly what we've got. So although we only have third-party insurance, we also have roadside assistance and some insurance for breakage of our windscreens and glass and those kind of things.
And those camping clubs, I mean, I think we pay 20 euros per year for that. And that also gives you sometimes other benefits, for instance, on booking ferries and other campsites.
And then, of course, there's some annual tax, which is like a vehicle tax, I suppose. But that will depend on the age of your vehicle and obviously the value of your vehicle and the country of residence. So it's a little bit tricky. And then lastly, another big one, which some of you may or may not have, is medical insurance or health insurance.
We've got international health insurance. Now, for us, this is a big expense because we don't have any insurance from any country that's fixed. And our cost is 2,200 euro per year. Obviously, this is very dependent on your age and what type of cover you are comfortable with.
Okay, just your final thoughts. Now, obviously, on medical, we do self-insure day-to-day expenses. Major medical expenses is covered in part of your insurance, but depends on, once again, yourself. So we're not going to get into those numbers. We have a few articles on our website to compare travel insurance with real medical cover or expat-style medical cover like we have. Before we wrap up, let me just say, if you look at the total number, what we spent, and this is the 30 euros 51 per day. Although these numbers are super useful to give you an idea what your travel expenses can be, it's not a reflection of total living costs. Now, as we live full-time on the road, we also have other expenses like our expensive toys, like Lisa's bicycle.
Surf gear,
kites, we have subs, we have...
Not to mention technology, cameras. You'll be surprised how much we have to spend on electronics just to keep this YouTube channel going.
But yes, we do spend money on laptops and cameras and connectivity. And I think our total living cost is probably about 3 times this daily. So, but that is, a lot of this is discretionary. So if we didn't buy the bicycles and the kitesurfing gear and the expensive camera, then we would be able to live a lot cheaper. So, but if you are considering this lifestyle, I can promise you, you can worth the equivalent of that per day live pretty comfortably.
I would average €1,000 a month is quite doable from a traveling perspective. And if you have other overhead expenses and want other nice toys and things like that, then you need to spend at least €2,000 per month. That would be a very rough estimate. But of course, it's very dependent on how you want to travel. But to do this for less than €1,000 a month is very tricky.
It's not impossible, but you have to stay in certain areas. So you have to spend a whole year, for example, in Spain, or split your time across cheaper destinations, like, for example, the Balkans as an option. Either way, to cut your cost, stop moving. Very simple. What other ways can we find to save money? Travel slower.
Travel slower, definitely. Prepare your own food.
Don't drink alcohol.
And the things that you are most likely to spend more on than us, I would say, is possibly sightseeing. Because every time you go somewhere for the first time also, you want to go into more cities, more museums, more absolute tourist sites. And those have all got entrance fees. In Europe, that can add up quite quickly. And then eating out. I think most people want to eat out, dine out a little bit more than we do. And that is a big, big expense.
We are done. We spent all our money. This is a new year. And in 12 months from now, we will be doing another budget. And it will be very interesting to see how it compares a year later.
We'll most likely also do a separate budget for Morocco after the time that we spent here.
Yes, because there's quite a lot of interest on that. So guys, as always, thanks for watching. If you haven't done so yet, hit the subscribe button.
Smash the like button.
I will see you in the next video.
Thanks for watching.